Hello friends, my name is Shivam from DevOps Schools and I will help you to enable your learning process in various technologies of DevOps, artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data and many more. This is our initiative to help you by sharing multiple tutorials and videos. And if you want any specific tutorials on any particular topic, then please do comment in the below comment section and I will help you with it. Also, please subscribe to our premium services on YouTube, which will give you access to more content and videos to enhance your knowledge about all these topics. Also, if you want me to help you with regards to the online trainings and classroom sessions by our qualified trainers, then please write me at contact@devopsschool.com. Thank you.
The next thing we are going to learn about is Kubernetes. Why you need Kubernetes when you have containers, Docker?
So actually in our organization, we are maintaining more than lakhs of containers. So to manage all of that containers, we use Kubernetes. And so we know about microservices, right? So for every microservice, for login page, we created only one server, and the server is only capable of 1,000 users. So, but the traffic, incoming traffic, is more than 1,000. At that time, we have to scale up that service. So at that time, Kubernetes is useful.
Okay, good. What else?
Well, in Kubernetes, we have the concept of pods, and inside the pods, you can run multiple Docker containers. Mainly, it's to manage multiple containers. Kubernetes makes it easy, and also reinstancing any particular container if something failure happened, that easily management can be done by Kubernetes. That's the thing.
Good. When we talk about Kubernetes, okay, it is in COE. It is in COE, container orchestration engine. Like this is one single machine. On top of that, I'm running some containers. Now, suddenly something happened to this machine. So all your application will go down. This is one of the biggest drawback of containerization. Okay, all the containers are also running as a process. If anything happened, everything will go down. So we need a solution. We want to make this as a highly available environment. To do the same, we require orchestration, or we need something called as cluster of servers. Which can help me to make my environment HA, highly available, or we required something called as resilient architecture. Like your container is running here, due to some reason, if this goes down, it will automatically run here or automatically run here. That type of solution I needed. Kubernetes help you to do the same. So it is a project which has been developed by Google as an open source next generation container scheduler. The job they have, they got the means Google also use. Most of the Google services are running on top of Kubernetes, but they don't call it Kubernetes. They have something different, Borg and Omega. So it is created as an, like Kubernetes is also one type of microservices. It's not like that. When I say loosely coupled, means it is a microservice Okay. The job is to deploy your container, maintain, and scaling your application. So when we talk about Kubernetes, it's a Linux kernel distribution system. So when we talk about Linux kernel distribution, so Kubernetes can be installed on top of Linux machine. Okay. It cannot be installed on top of Windows. We have mini cubes and those things. Those are for testing environment. But for production environment, we use we will always use Kubernetes cluster. So there will be a master component in Kubernetes and there is node component. Previously it has been called as so in master component, it is a control panel. When we talk about control panel, it the job of the master panel is to run your API server, scheduler, cluster controller. It also store your cluster state. It talks to the cloud provider. And when we talk about nodes, they are worker of a Kubernetes cluster. Its job is to run your application on top of your node. So this is the architecture of Kubernetes. When we talk about architecture, so what you required is you required multiple Linux system. On top of those multiple Linux system, okay, you need to run a container runtime. So both the machine, master, worker, everything will have something called as everywhere you need to have something called as container runtime, either Docker, systemd or CRIO. Any container engine should be running. Why we need a container engine to be running? If you want to install
containers.
Mm-hmm. What else? All the services in Kubernetes are running as a container. Like cloud control manager, kube control manager, scheduler, proxy, additional service, API servers, etc. Everything is running as a container. That is the reason we require container runtime. If I don't have container runtime, I cannot run my Kubernetes cluster. Like in Kubernetes, all the services are running as a container runtime. So these are the master component like API server, etcd, control manager, cloud control manager, kube scheduler. What is that API server? It is an interface. When we talk about interface, like once you deploy your Kubernetes cluster, to communicate with Kubernetes cluster, it happens through that API server. Means like in Docker, we use Docker command to communicate with Docker engine. Similar to that, to interact with Kubernetes, we will use kubectl or kubectl. But the kubectl request, like if I want to talk to any of this container or if I want to use any of these services, the request go to API server. Then the API send the request to all these services. Now, what is the benefit of API server? Why they have put that communication should happen to the Kubernetes cluster strictly through the API server? What is the benefit that your cluster should communicate with the API server. Why you need to communicate with using an API? What is API?
Application programming
interface. Communicating interface.
Communicating interface.
Yeah. So when you do communicating using an API, it is always a secure communication. Okay, like you have heard about, like Facebook has exposed their API, Google has exposed their API. Why they are exposing the APIs? Directly you cannot log into any of the Google server or Google server or Facebook server. Like I have done some promotion, I want to download certain reports, or I want to integrate some like I am developing an application which is related to social networking. I want to post some updates and patch updates. So I do it through API only. API means they expose their functionality in their application. They expose their functionality in their application using API. So when we communicate through API, it is always a secure communication. So Kubernetes has taken this as the de facto standard. So anything in Kubernetes, if you want to communicate, it will always happen through the API. So in Kubernetes, Kube API server is nothing. It is a service which is getting installed. It help you to validate your request to go to which services. Then they have something called as etcd. What etcd do is, it is a data store. When we talk about data store, okay, it is a sometimes also called as it store your cluster state. Like in Kubernetes, I have like running 1.8 version. Later on, I got 1.9 version. I want to update my cluster from 1.8 to 1.9. So all the cluster information are being stored in etcd. So etcd will always have the backup of your cluster. If you do not keep, like I am upgrading my cluster, I have upgraded my cluster from one version to another version. If you do not restore the etcd, your cluster will be like a new cluster. Okay. Etcd contains your cluster state, means not about cluster state, like how many worker node are there, how many master nodes are there, then how many pods are running, how many containers are running in simple term, how they are communicating, how the cluster manager is working, how it is communicating with the cloud service provider. All those information are being stored in etcd. Is it clear what is Kube API and what is etcd in master? What is Kube API?
Kube API provides whenever we type any command in kubectl, it will request to Kube API. It validated Kube API and it will hit the required
service. Yes. What is etcd?
It's a key value data store. It contains a state of the like
the cluster.
Cluster.
Kubernetes.
Yeah.
Okay. So always take a frequent backup of etcd. Then we have a kube control manager. Okay. It is managing all your components. It control loops. It monitor the cluster state. What is there in the kube control manager? It contains your endpoint. It contains the replica controller. It manage your replica controller. It manage your containers. It manage, it control your resource quota. It control your namespaces, services, daemon set, job controller, deployment, replica set, HPA controller, signing certificate authority, cleaner controller, TTL services, node lifecycle controller. So kube control manager, the job of kube control manager is to manage all your services in Kubernetes. Cloud control manager, like by default, when you, if you look into this diagram, by default, if I deploy, by default, if I deploy a container, okay, by default, they are running inside your Kubernetes cluster. By default, they are running inside your Kubernetes cluster. You cannot access the same outside Kubernetes cluster. If you want to access the same outside Kubernetes cluster, you need to create a route or expose a service. So all these things happen through Cloud Control Manager. Not only that, it manages your storage also. Kube Scheduler.
To schedule the pods and in the worker nodes, it will help.
Affinity, anti-affinity, or if you want to have some custom resource, those are being managed using scheduler. And in node, we have kubelet, kubeproxy, and container runtime. You can see that there is a service called as kubelet, okay? It is running everywhere. Why it is running everywhere? Kubelet is not a container, it is a service. Like Docker is a service similar to that. Container runtime is a service similar to that. Kubelet is also a service. What is there everywhere?
Because if you type any command in kubectl, how it will interact with the with the worker node and the master node.
No, that is the interaction happen through CNI, container network interface. Who knows about kubelet? Like I schedule a container, like I deploy a container in node one. I deploy a container. I want to deploy a application container application on my Kubernetes cluster. So what I have done, I create a deployment or a pod.yaml file. Inside that, I define how it is going to be deployed and push it to the my master node. And master node will look into any of this pod wherever the resource is available. And according to that, it will deploy. But how master node, like in master node, the scheduler is there. How the scheduler in master node will know that where is my resource available? Like in node one, I have 1,000 containers running. In node two, I have around 500 containers running. I have a capacity of 1,000. So kubelet is nothing, it is an agent which is installed in all the machine. What it do? It provide your cluster information, like how many pods are running, how much resources they are using. All those information kubelet send it to container run, kubelet send it to the through API server. It is distribute those information to all this services. So the job of kubelet is to, it's like an agent which gather your system information, how many containers are running and everything, and it is putting it to the master node. That is one job. The other job is, if any of your container on worker node has been failed, how master will know that it need to restart that service or it need to schedule it in a different machine. So all these things are being done using kubelet. So the job of kubelet is to gather system information and send it to the master machine. Is it clear what is kubelet now? What kubelet do?
Gather information from the nodes and send it to the master.
What type of information it collect?
Like how many ports are running and and how many ports are available, how many we can run. It will tell status of that.
So job of Kubernetes, this kubelet is to send information to the master node. Not only that, it will also take care of if any of the container has gone down. So it need to inform the replica controller that start that container again. Okay, all those information are being sent through kubelet. What kubeproxy do? Why you need a proxy? Why you need proxy?
To act as a single gateway and aggregate the request for that particular node.
Once you deploy your application, how you are going to expose it outside Kubernetes cluster? By default, they are running internally. Okay. If you want to expose them outside Kubernetes cluster, it happens through a proxy. The job of proxy server is to expose your container outside Kubernetes cluster. Clear? Any doubt on any of these services except pod? I will explain you what is pod.
Yeah. Gopal, take example, multiple Docker containers are running, okay, and some Docker container stop at the same time, okay. Here, how Kubernetes take a decision that that particular pod need to be replaced with new pod and those things?
I am coming on that.
Okay, and another thing you told about the kubeproxy, right? The kubeproxy, what normally it do that?
Like by default, all the containers are running internally, means they are in the private network. You cannot access them outside Kubernetes cluster. But if it is a front-end based application, okay, which need to be accessed by everyone, so it happens through that kubeproxy service. That is the reason it is there in the master also and all the worker.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can see that the load balancer has been attached. Like if you have an external cloud service provider load balancer, like AWS application load balancer, it has been attached with the Kube proxy server. Is it right?
But here you see Kubetel is present, Kubelet is present for every master node and child node. Okay.
The job of Kubelet is to gather your system information.
What is the kubectl work?
Kubectl is a command line to interact with your Kubernetes cluster. Like to interact with my Docker machines, how I use Docker container, Docker, the name of the container, and I interact. Is it right? Similar to that, to interact with Kubernetes cluster, like I want to interact with cloud control manager, or I want to interact with scheduler, everything happens through kubectl. So kubectl is nothing, it is a command line which we use it to communicate with our Kubernetes cluster. Understand?
Okay. This whole work setup done for any application, yeah, for enterprise application, by maximum DevOps people do this whole thing, analyze every part, right?
It's not like that DevOps guy is going to do all these things, okay? Nowadays, DevOps is like the definition has been changed, anyone can do it. Because kubectl, like you learn about Docker similar to that. You need to learn about Kubernetes also. DevOps guy means previously, like he knows about development also, he knows about operation also. But the scenario has been changed. Like if you know development and operation, okay, go to US, you can earn $200 per hour, okay, both of them if you know thoroughly. Nowadays, they what as per DevOps, the concept has been changed. What they have done is, DevOps is like a team where the development team will be there, the operation team will be there, like network engineer, storage, admin, everything will be sitting together to achieve one single goal. Okay. Previously, what happened? There is a communication gap between developer and operation team. But now, to avoid those communication gaps, it comes up with DevOps, which is a all the engineers sitting together and become a DevOps. Like once you are previously, what happened is that software deployment development takes plenty of time, then it comes to operation for deployment. But nowadays, like software development and deployment takes 1 day, 7 days, or maximum 21 days sprint. You got it. Depends upon how major software deployment is there. Okay. So if I have to finish my job in 1 day, 7 days, and 21 days and give it to the customer for acceptance. Okay. So in that type of scenario, I need to put all the engineers together. Then only it can be achieved. So like, I have seen that in organization, they put their designation as DevOps. If you know 100% development and you know 100% operation, then only you can call yourself DevOps. And otherwise, the DevOps funda has been changed. It is like a team, okay, which achieve a single goal. Okay, or in simple term, like once you develop a software also, it should be quality software development should be done. Okay.
To get our channel membership, click onto the join button, select the 3D99 plan, and grow your skills immensely.
So like some of you are from the operation background. Tomorrow I will tell you that you start developing. You cannot do it. Hardly 10% people can do it. And tomorrow I move you, some of you are developer. Now I will tell you to manage the whole AWS or Azure cloud. It's not possible. Yeah, we know that everything has been simplified. But then also there are a lot of drawbacks. So it's better that involve everyone, achieve a single goal. I never put myself as a DevOps consultant because little bit drawback also I have it. Like I know development, like Java, Node.js, and Python development, I know. Okay. I know operation thoroughly, like maintaining an AWS or Azure cloud architecture also. But when it comes to like big data, Hadoop, and all those things, I never understand those concepts. Okay. I'm not good in database. So if I am sitting in a project, I don't involve that DB guy. I blindly say that I am a DevOps guy, 100%, I know everything. And my biggest drawback is working with the NoSQL database. SQL database I know because I am a Sybase guy. So for me, Oracle or anything. But then also I need to involve them, okay, to have a good database. Okay. NoSQL, it goes out of my mind. Never understand what is that one. Okay. So later on, like if you join an organization as an DevOps team lead, you have to involve everyone. Okay. Clear? And in operation also, you need to update yourself with new technologies like Ansible, Terraform. Those things you should be aware of. Clear? What is DevOps now?
Yeah.
Kubernetes, like people has 20 years of experience in this technology, but they never worked with Docker or Kubernetes. Okay, they are very good in other technologies. Tomorrow, if you give him Kubernetes and Docker, do you think that they can start working on the same day? You need to explain them for a month, then only they will understand Docker. After 1 month, they will start understanding Kubernetes. And Kubernetes is like an ocean. Like recently, a month back, Gartner has published a report that stop making data scientists start working on Kubernetes because there are so many drawbacks in Kubernetes. Okay. It's not very easy to handle Kubernetes cluster. In your organization, are you using Kubernetes cluster?
Yeah, we do use. We also use the Rancher on Kubernetes as well.
I know, but Kubernetes cluster, like it is being deployed on top of normal virtual machine. Or are you using Kubernetes as a service from Amazon or Azure?
Yes, GKS, they are using EKS and AKS.
Why you people are using it? You can deploy your Kubernetes cluster and do it. That is also a way, but that is a pain. Okay. That is a pain. Because when you start developing your own Kubernetes cluster, okay, it's a full-fledged data center solution. You have to deploy a lot of things like service mesh, how Kubernetes backup will happen through Valerio, how you are going to manage package management in Kubernetes using Helm chart or chart museum. So many things will come, okay? So all this is being done using a team, okay? Same team is there with Amazon. Amazon do not have any issue with teams. Okay, they can hire. So why we are using AKS and EKS and this thing, the reason behind this, 90% of my job, like storage, packaging, and everything has been managed by the Amazon, like Citibank. They have moved some of the core service to Kubernetes. Not in India, it is in Costa Rica, one of the part in US. Okay. They have some huge data center in Costa Rica for North Atlantic America. They have deployed Kubernetes, okay, round the clock. There are more than 60 engineers who is working on those clusters. Why they have done it on premises? Because they are 100% financial. I don't know what they do it in that place. And they don't want to put their databases in on top of cloud. Okay. Most of, like recently, if you heard about it, US government is also deploy some solution on Kubernetes, not on Amazon and Azure. They have their on premises data center. There they have deployed. Okay. Nowadays, like their F16 is also running through Kubernetes cluster only. So Kubernetes is like everywhere, from flight operation to all the 5G implementation. Okay, like I work with Amdocs with AT&T. All the 5G implementation is happening through Kubernetes cluster only. They are not deploying on top of physical. Like racks, by default, all telecom industry, what they used to do is they deploy 4G, 3G, 2G using using VMware cluster and all those things. But now they are strictly doing it through Kubernetes cluster because that only gives you them faster communication. Yeah, any doubt?
Gopal, we, the Fidelity now started using Kubernetes as a service on the rancher. I mean, it's what is like, you know, maybe Fidelity is moving towards the Kubernetes, there must have the cluster, but we as a developer do not have much information inside the operations part. The only thing we know that we just deploy it, the application in our and packaging and to add a factory to the rancher, all those things, but we don't have the high level information on any of it, or documentation or anything. Do we have like an example for end to end, like, you know, have the application deploy on some
environment? We're talking about this rancher.
Yeah. Rancher migration. We just have started rancher migration.
There is no migration in rancher. Why you are migrating it? You don't need to migrate anything on rancher. Rancher is being used for managing multiple Kubernetes cluster.
Okay. Like
currently what happened is that if you have 10 Kubernetes cluster, okay, I log into every single Kubernetes cluster and working on it, okay, using rancher I can manage all the Kubernetes cluster together, okay.
Okay.
The job of rancher is to manage all those Kubernetes cluster together. Okay. They are adding all the Kubernetes cluster on top of rancher so that you will have one single interface. Like you log into Amazon. So you got all the data centers. Is it right?
Yes.
US East, Oregon.
Yeah, we have the Virginia, US East, Virginia thing.
Yeah. In US, they have four locations, Ohio, Oregon, then California, and some more locations are there. Yeah. And Asia Pacific. But one single login ID, I can manage all the services in Amazon, every location. Similar to that, if you have multiple Kubernetes cluster, okay? for every project, like for every client we have created, like in your Fidelity also, we have multiple internal clients, is it right? Every client required their own Kubernetes cluster. Like for insurance sector, there is a different Kubernetes cluster. For finance, there will be a different Kubernetes cluster. For data management, there will be a different Kubernetes cluster. But I want to manage them together one single screen. I don't need to log into every Kubernetes cluster. I don't need to log into every single Kubernetes cluster and manage it. Okay, so in that type of scenario.
So it is just that, like a dashboard or something like that, that you can manage.
It's not a dashboard, cluster. Like once you add all this cluster, once you add all this cluster together, okay, like I can deploy, I can, like using a GUI interface, using a GUI interface, I can deploy my solution. I can add new storage. I can add new nodes. Like in Amazon, I want to add one more nodes. Like currently in my cluster, there is a bottleneck going on. I need to add one more server. So we don't need to go to EC2, do next. Okay. Just provide the Amazon secret key and access key. Blender will automatically, it will give you the option that what type of instance type you want to launch, which OS do you want to launch it. It automatically launch it for you. Okay. Those type of all the maintenance works has been taken care by that rancher cluster.
Gopal, so that raises two questions for me. Number one is like, so you're saying it is just like a management tool or like a WebSphere or something like that to manage the number of
Kubernetes containers.
Do we have any restrictions with the number of clusters that it can manage?
No, in Rancher there is no restriction available, but like Fidelity, okay, they have taken the enterprise edition of Rancher. Okay, so in enterprise edition, like if you want to manage around 10 cluster, we pay 10 cluster price. If more than that is
okay,
there
across yeah. Geolocations, right? No geography location restrictions.
Rancher, you deploy it in one single machine. From there, you can manage all the Kubernetes cluster. Like, if time permit, tomorrow we will deploy Rancher. I'll connect few of your cluster and show it to you.
Sure, thanks.
It is an open source solution, but there are some activity which they don't give free of cost. Like in your Kubernetes cluster, you want to do some compliance, like CVV scoring, content vulnerability scoring. So those comes in Rancher Enterprise Edition. Other than that, most of the services you can use it. Okay. Clear?
The question is Gopal, yeah, see one single machine, right? And if you have like, let's say 1,000, not 1,000, but it's a kind of container, but like, you know, about 5 Kubernetes cluster, which has number of nodes, X number of nodes, how this machine can handle that much? You know, it's.
That is, I just give you an example. Okay. You can make that rancher highly available.
Oh, okay.
You can deploy it on top of Kubernetes also.
Okay.
You can deploy it on top of Docker Swarm also. Just need a Rancher is a container engine. Okay. Just need Docker installed or that's all. And it is not like that you can manage Kubernetes cluster. You can manage the OpenShift cluster using Rancher also. You can manage Apache Mesos container platform using Rancher. It's a multi-platform. Okay.
Okay.
So when we talk about container orchestration, it is not like that only Kubernetes is there. OpenShift is also there. Apache Mesos is also there. OpenShift is fully chargeable. Apache Mesos is so complicated, it's like it give you a full-fledged data center solution. Very hardly few people use it. Like I have seen it in JPMC, JP Morgan. They are using Apache Mesos for managing their container application.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else? Anyone has question related to Kubernetes master or node? No one? None of you have any question? What is pod in Kubernetes? Why you need pod?
Pod is just like a running environment which supports the multiple containers. You can consider just like a how we can consider a multiple Docker container concept, just like for Kubernetes, pod will just like a separate container which manage multiple Docker container inside.
Okay.
It's a
what else? What is pod?
It's a set of containers, like a group of containers, like you used to tell, right? Like we'll be creating a custom cluster kind of thing. So we can, in this case, we can create a custom pod which will have, let's say, our required number of containers sharing the same resources.
Good. What else? Why you need pod?
Gopal, it's for extending storage in Kubernetes.
Okay. What else?
Or we can say an extendable or portable storage, we can say.
Anyone else? What is pod? Tell me, what is pod? I need answer.
Gopal, you know, you mentioned something in yesterday about the microservices, that, you know, if in your payment example, I'm taking it, like, you know, if you have the small chunk of, like, you know, the services that you develop, okay, and as a group or that when you wanted to deploy, it has to be in the same way. So is that the correct that you know, it is the smallest deployable units of your application code?
Yeah, you can say. What else?
Pod is nothing but a small object that can deploy deployable object in Kubernetes.
That is bookish definition.
Because they are communicating its services with each other, so it might have to share all information related to each other. Means you know from the network to the application layer.
Good. What else?
Running instance. One running instance in a cluster.
It is a wrapper over container, like it manage. It can also manage multiple containers.
Yes, something like that. Like I told you earlier, also all the interaction happen in Kubernetes through Kube API. Okay, pod is also an API. In Kubernetes, pod is also an API. Okay. So to deploy an container based application, to deploy an container based application, we have to use pod API. We need to invoke pod API, then only I can deploy the same in Kubernetes. Is it clear? Is it clear, all of you, till here?
Yes, Gopal.
Pod has another benefit. Okay, if you have a multi-container application. When we talk about multi-container application, like front-end, three-tier architecture, front-end, back-end, you have something called a sidecar pattern also. I will come on that. Like this is my front-end. This is my back-end. And this is my sidecar pattern. Now, when you deploy this, pod, okay, this is your I called it my app pod. Okay, what it will do is it will ensure that all these three containers, it will ensure that all these three containers are always running on top of one single node. Okay, so if all these three containers are running, like what happens is that in my cluster I have multiple master, and there are so many containers are there. If my front end is running on this node 1, the back end is running on node 2, the sidecar pattern is running on some other node, what will happen? The communication between front end, back end, and sidecar pattern is slow. Okay, they cannot communicate easily. Okay, because the traffic will go from one node to another node. So what pod ensure that all the time all these three containers are running on top of one single node. So what will happen is that all three of them are working as in simple term, we called it, it's like a local area network. Like your database is somewhere in India and your front end is in US. So what will happen? The communication gap will be there. Okay, the traffic flow through internet So what pod ensure that all these three containers inside your application should always be running on top of one single machine. Okay. Is it clear? What is pod? The second option.
Definition, what we can say.
So pod ensure that, pod definition ensure that all of your container are running on, like I have one single app, like financial app I have created, the payment gateway I have created. So my payment gateway has multiple containers. Okay, like encryption check has been done by one container. The balance check has been done by one container. The merchant backing verification has been done by all one container. The pod definition ensures that all these three containers are being put on top of one single machine. Then only the communication between the container are fast. Okay. And it is, as per the definition, they call it, this is the smallest unit of deployment in Kubernetes. Tell me, any doubt on pod now? Have you understand pod? What is pod now?
So how does that resource management happen within the pod? Like, let's say I instantiate 10 containers, all will be sharing the same resource that is assigned to the pod equally, or like on the, depending on the load or how?
By default, there is no resource management. Okay, you need to define quota on your pod level also. Like, this container should not use more than half core processor or 1 GB of RAM. That you can allocate in Kubernetes. Okay, by default there is no resource quota applied, but if you want it, you can apply it.
Okay.
Just it ensure that all this container are being running on top of one single machine. Okay. Go ahead. Any more doubt anyone has related to pod? All of you, is it clear now? What is pod now? Anyone who has not understand, tell me. Am I clear or not on pod definition?
Yes, Gopal.
Yes, Gopal, you're fine.
What is sidecar pattern?
Database.
So Gopal, that is the you mentioned here is like, you know, most of e-commerce, like, you know, application including our Fidelity, all of them are on the three-tier architecture, right? So basically in that sense, you know, all the front end meteor and the back end, it's just like, you know, you put in the cart, and then all three of them is related to that particular services or application that you are developing to be on the same thing. So you can got from front end to end and retrieve, update, whatever you can do, you just have it on the same
yes.
part. Is that true?
That is one example. The other example, like I need to monitor this front end and back end also, is it right?
Yeah, Gopal. So we can say like number of applications that you are side by side, we're just putting it and tightly coupling it with each other, a kind of small microservices running, so that we can say a sidecut button.
Something like that, but when you need to use it, like this is my front end, this is my back end, they generate logs, is it right?
Please enroll our general membership for $399 plan to get access of all the parts.
Along with that, you can access our other tutorials such as Docker, Ansible, Jenkins, Terraform, Splunk, AWS, Azure, and various other DevOps related premium tutorials with our channel membership. If you would have any issues with our channel membership, you can drop an email to us at contact@devopschool.com, or you can also unsubscribe from channel membership anytime if you don't want to continue or did not like the video. To get our channel membership, click onto the join button, select the $399 plan, and grow your skills immensely.
Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries. We will reply to them at the earliest.
Thanks for watching.